योगः कर्मसु कौशलम्।
नमस्कार, आई एम डॉक्टर अनुराधा पागेदार, PhD इन लॉ, एंड माय जनरल इंटरेस्ट्स आर जेंडर स्टडीज एंड स्पेशली विमेन एस्टीम, एंड दैट्स द रीजन व्हाई माय PhD इज इन द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ ह्यूमन राइट्स, एंड आई स्ट्राइव फॉर द वेरी थिंग that every woman should be basically and primarily considered as a human being first. I welcome all the participants of this refresher course. And to begin with, I would like to thank the University Grants Commission Human Resource Development Center of Gujarat University, and special thanks to the director of this department, Dr. Jagdish Joshi, for rendering me this opportunity to be able to connect with all of you from all over. Importantly, this center has a significance of conducting number of refresher courses in various subjects by which thousands of participants and faculties have really benefited. Today's my topic as a resource person of this FDP, the Faculty Development Program, is importance of, or rather relevance of, the CWDC and the ICC, the Internal Complaints Committee, in any higher education institute. To begin with, before I start with my presentation, let me tell you, there are a number of people who keep on asking, okay, what is the basic need of having these what is the basic need of having specially in the case of when we are all developed, empowered in this refresher course in the law with the subject evaluating laws and policies in India from the lens of 21st century reality. We all know that we are in the 21st century. We all are aware of the fact that in the 21st century, the reality is number of women have leaped forward, they are educated. Then what is the significance of this? But then, there is another very important stark reality that there are existing internal complaint committees and the women's development cells in higher education institutions. Today, I will be helping you to understand and develop the basic reason and the idea of having these in every higher education institute. There have been recurring questions. All women are educated and education is very easily available to all the citizens of India. Literacy is definitely there. People know how to read, write. They are aware of so many things, various subjects. Women have been empowered. And there are existing laws also which are there. There is a very broad legislative framework for protection of rights of women. And there is also judiciary. And there is this question which has been asked to me by educated people also several times. Despite existence of all these, why the need of internal complaint committee and the collegiate women's development cells or committees in higher education institutions? With this question, I would like all of you to have a look at this picture. I have selected this slide specially with an intention to make all of us have a look at the gender disparity existing in our society. And therefore, the slide which I have chosen also says, if you look from this side, it looks different in the blue color. If you look it from this side, it looks different. Equality. It's not mandatory, compulsory. It isn't voluntary. It is the necessity of the day. With the time, with the progress, unless and until there is equality, we won't be able to leap forward as a developing nation anymore. People say women are empowered, but then the more it grows upwards, the lesser it is deeply rooted. This slide will help me to make you understand, or in a way would like all of you to understand that empowerment is more of a talked about subject, more of discussed rather than being deeply rooted in the Indian society. I have chosen this picture of an iceberg. This picture of iceberg will help me to help you get sensitized towards what I want to convey to all of you today with my presentation. Through the lens of 21st century, if we are trying to look at this portion of this iceberg, the portion which is seen outside is only 1/10 or 1/100 at times, and the below portion is totally submerged below the sea level or below or under the water. If people are talking that laws are there to protect women, there is judiciary, there are police, then let me tell you, they are available for only this portion of the iceberg which is actually seen. What about those who are still under the water level? What about those women who have not? I'm comparing the position of women with the iceberg, and therefore this image, dear participants. What about all those who have yet not got an opportunity to assert themselves? This should be able to make all of you start thinking about the reality of women in society. People say women today are empowered, they are powerful, they have achieved heights in their own way. But then, this is only about those who are just the tip of the iceberg and not about everyone else. The meaning of ICC and CWDC. ICC means the Internal Complaints Committee, and CWDC is called as the Collegiate Women's Development Committee. At university level in Gujarat University, it is called as Collegiate Women's Development Cell or Women's Development Cell, that is. But when it is at a college level, it is called as Collegiate Women's Development Committee, and at university level, it is called as a cell. It comes to our mind that this kind of arrangement, why is it required in the 21st century? It is required because, let me tell you, higher education institution is also a system, and every system is required to be foolproof. Every system must be self-compliant, and every system also should have empathy towards the people who are constituent part of that system. Higher education institute would have teachers, students, girls, boys, employees, administrative staff, and there would be number of people on the campus. Therefore, if at all there is a grievance, the grievance should be a structure, the grievance redressal should be properly structured. It should be structured and should be manned by people who are compassionate in nature. With compassion, they should be concerned. They should be exhibiting concern for the problems which are faced by girl students on the campus. With an assurance that there will be some or the other kind of positive outcome as a result of establishment of these internal complaints committee and the CWDCs. We shall be discussing about the ICC, Internal Complaints Committee, as well as the CWDC at length in this lecture. This all came up with the landmark judgment given in the case of Vishakha and others versus State of Rajasthan. I have also shared the reference of the case with the citation. It was this case in which the court provided some certain absolutely to be observed guidelines for institutions. At that time, later on, it will come to your mind, it will be very clear to you that educational institutions also became an integral part of it to provide a safe working environment. It is a guideline of this case that it shall be the duty to provide a safe working environment to each and every employee at the workplace or at the place which is an educational institute. And at such institute, it should be very properly and conspicuously displayed that what are the consequences of indulging in acts that may constitute to sexual harassment. The composition of the internal committee of that organization also should be displayed. It aims at having an organizing workshops, awareness programs at regular intervals for sensitizing the employees on these issues and implications of the same at workplace. Of the same means of the sexual harassment. Organizing orientation programs for members of the internal complaints committee so that they are also updated regarding the laws, as well as in those such sharing programs, they would be coming across a certain incidents which have taken place maybe in the past or recent past, which will help them or which will be a guiding factor for them to deal with such problem on their respective campus. The Vishakha guideline says that sexual harassment must be treated as a misconduct under the service rules, and an action can be initiated for the same for misconduct. Here, the employer is required to monitor the timely submission of reports by the ICC. So the liability or the onus now lies on the employer making the person responsible for any kind of untoward incident. And if at all is reported, if at all taken care of, it must be properly reported also. The Vishakha guidelines also help with providing the basic fact that the act of sexual harassment must be very affirmatively discussed with the people around. What happens in our Indian society is people do not have a tendency of explaining, expressing or sharing or discussing acts like sexual harassment. Basically, the certain words like sex, sexuality, sexual, these are not very openly discussed, but openly understood. See the difference. But then the time is now when they must be discussed. The consequences of such act must be discussed at the workers' meetings, employer-employee meetings, and the guidelines of this particular case of the Vishakha and others versus State of Rajasthan. These guidelines force the educational institutions to have such kind of organization or a committee for the purpose of arresting the misconduct of sexual harassment. As I told you earlier, the liability of the employer grows. The employer should assist the persons affected in the case of sexual harassment by outsiders also. The central and the state government must adopt measures, including legislation, to ensure that private employers are also observing these guidelines. And whosoever are the members of the Internal Complaints Committee, their names their contact numbers must be prominently displayed so that if at all a person is a victim, if at all a person is fearful, if at all a person is not in position to express, then that particular contact number will be a guiding factor for that person to establish a contact with that committee member and report the incident which has taken place. With this, the Internal Complaints Committee and the Collegiate Women's Development Committee at the college level is expected to be sensitive, responsive, responsible, and accountable. This is my suggestion to each and every person who is directly or indirectly attached with higher education institution. See, the seekers of higher education are human beings. The educators are also human beings, and each and every person is different from another by way of intentions. And when the intentions differ, it might result in actually taking away somebody's dignity and rights. Therefore, sensitivity is more important. So, the establishment of these committees in the institutions must necessarily have an approach of being sensitive, responsive, responsible, at the same time accountable to others. If at all they are not taking a proper legal action, not legal, sorry, if they are not taking a proper action where they are supposed to, why shouldn't they be held accountable for inaction or for not dynamically taking the cognizance of the report, cognizance of the complaint of the such victim? Whatsoever laws are related to women, all the laws, we all of us know that they are about the rights. Why anybody should know their rights? So that the person can assert the rights timely. And this would be possible only and only if the person has the knowledge of the rights. And why there should be proper knowledge of rights or to all of us or to all the individuals to prevent the crimes against women, as well as ultimately resulting in protection of women from such crime. Now let us discuss about the CWDC. Each college and recognized institution shall have a collegiate women's development committee to deal with any kind of harassment, including sexual harassment. Each college or institution shall inform the cell about the members of CWDC, and if at all any alteration is there in the committee, it also should be properly notified. The CWDC shall submit its half-yearly report of the activities of the cell. In the composition of CWDC, as you can see on the screen, it should be comprised of 6 members, can be 5 also. The head, the director, or principal of the institution should be the chairman. The principal will be the chairman. There would be 2 members of teaching staff, amongst whom one should be a female member. 1 woman member from non-teaching staff of the college of that recognized institution. 2 students from the college would be representatives on this committee, amongst which 1 female member is expected to be the representative. The female members of teaching staff shall be the convener or coordinator of the committee. We have understood the creation of the CWDC, but then what is expected of this body after being established? The main and the primary objective would be to create a safe environment on the campus. Merely creating safe environment should result in encouragement of self-reliance and, more importantly, spreading awareness about legal provisions among the girl students as well as boys. Why only girl students? There should be awareness about legal provisions amongst the boys also. Now, how does it actually work? Any student or a woman employee of the college shall have a right to lodge a complaint with any member of the committee if there is any untoward incident, and such complaint can be in oral as well as in writing. I am talking about the women's development cells. It can be orally done or in writing. The complaint committee shall afford a fair and reasonable opportunity to the defendant to defend and ensure the observance of principles of natural justice. It is totally laid on the foundation that the party against whom the allegations have been made must be rendered a reasonable opportunity of being heard. And after that, the WDC or the CWDC can take the following actions. The offender can be given a warning that please try to improve upon your conduct, your behavior. A written apology can be sought from such person, or a bond related to good behavior can be sought from such person. And at times, if required, suspension for a specified period of time as per the norms decided by the organization. The person could be suspended for a particular period of time. Basically, protection of women from sexual harassment, there were legal provisions, but then with enhanced participation of women, with enhanced participation resulted in women actually being subjected to an atmosphere where there would be people of different intentions. So a legislation of this kind became a necessity, as a result of which the Vishakha case made the Supreme Court give this particular guideline of establishment of such committees and the internal complaints committee at higher education level. So what is the relevance of the CWDC? Simply having a established WDC or CWDC will not suffice the purpose. It should be able to provide an atmosphere of skill development to the children, to the students. So it provides a platform to the girl students. It becomes a place where they can identify a place of their own, where they can express themselves, they can share their views, and it gives a feeling of collective action. And ultimately, and most importantly, they feel important that this is a place where we can really rely upon for our problems and look forward to the solution of the same. The aims and objectives of these would be to promote gender equality. As this is a law faculty these are the participants are from law faculty. Gender equality and equality before law and Article 14, we all are aware of that. But then, in reality, even in 21st century, the place where we work, I have come across number of colleges having incidents like having problem of stalking, having problem of being harassed, even during the transportation from their home to their educational institution. So modernity, education has not added to decreasing the number of incidents. It has actually added to it. To promote gender equality should be the main objective. To provide a platform exclusively for the girl students. To provide or create, not only to provide, or rather create harmonious atmosphere for coexistence while in the institution. To help them recognize their potential, to ensure personality development along with their academic development, to promote a culture of zero tolerance against exploitation. This will be the duty of the educator or the academician or the professor or the lecturer at the college level. This will be the duty to actually help the girl students have the knowledge about all this, and ultimately then it would result into their changed psyche of being zero tolerant towards such incidents. There could be number of programs. Here in this particular refresher course, I have decided to share certain programs which I have conducted in my educational institution, and you may add number of them, but this is just a guiding factor as a help to the other faculties in their colleges under the ICC or under the WDC. They can carry out these programs so that the committee, the internal complaints committee or the CWDC, will not only remain just bodies created, and if there is no case reported or if there is no other problem, then what is the use of these committees? जब प्यास लगेगी तभी कुआ नहीं खोदने जा सकते हैं हम. वी एज एजुकेटर्स हैव अ रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ ट्रेनिंग द स्टूडेंट्स डायरेक्टली और इनडायरेक्टली. सो दीज आर द लिस्ट ऑफ प्रोग्राम्स विच वी कुड कंडक्ट फॉर द पर्पज ऑफ एनहैंसिंग देयर स्किल्स, एनहैंसिंग देयर सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस, एनहैंसिंग देयर सेल्फ एस्टीम. सो आई हैव कैरिड आउट दिस काइंड ऑफ प्रोग्राम ऑफ एक्चुअली डिस्प्लेइंग द हेल्पलाइन नंबर. Physical fitness is also equally important if they have to face any such kind of incident. Understanding the gender concept. And these programs could be participative programs by boys as well as girls or of from any gender. If there is a subject like success has no gender, for example, then if I want the students to write an essay on this topic, that success has no gender, this will definitely promote them to think about it several times. This will help them write about it, and ultimately it will result in sharing of their ideas. This is what is expected in any educational institution. Simply for complaints, simply for grievance redressal, of course they are there for grievance redressal. They would be compassionate, they would be helpful to them, and it is their duty, it is a part of their duty. But this will be another a step taken forward for the purpose of achieving the aims and objectives of existence of these societies or the committees. Dressing sense development is also equally important. We regularly carry out a visit to women's police station in Ahmedabad. We also visit the legal aid center. What happens is, the expected outcome is, some of you while going through this lecture might feel, okay, ma'am, you have given a suggestion, we would try to implement it, but then what would be the outcome? I'm also giving you the expected outcome. The expected outcome, according to me, is not just written on these slides. It is my experience of more than 25 years which has helped me to come out to this outcome. The students get a practical training of being participative. They get the first-hand experience, and the information they have will motivate them to help others. It would be resulting in peer counseling. They will have an enhanced self-esteem. The students will definitely tend to become vocal about their problems. Participative nature will be created, resulting in realization, identification of their self-worth. And as a result, the norms of the society, you should go out at this time, and if you are not returning home before 8 p.m. or 7 p.m., then you are a bad girl or a good girl. These kind of societal norms will stop affecting them anymore, because they would have themselves created a confidence. They would be themselves confident to understand the basic fact that they are aware of who they are. This, I believe, should be the main objective of establishment of these collegiate women's development cells as well as the internal complaints committee. Now let us all have a look at the sexual harassment of women at workplace, Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act of 2013. All of us know about the existence of this law. All of us are aware of this act, but then it is this act which will help all of us to make our students understand what will be treated as sexual harassment. So let us try to understand the definition as given by this act. I have made it an explanatory. In simple words, we could tell the students that any kind of physical contact or advances, a demand or request for sexual favors, sexually colored remarks, showing pornography or any other unwelcome physical, verbal or non-verbal conduct of sexual nature will be termed as sexual harassment, and it is an offense. Which are other acts amounting to harassment? Implied or explicit promise of preferential treatment in any kind of employment. All people who are employed must know about these facts. Simply because somebody is appreciating you that you are well dressed does not mean. If it is welcome, if it is mutual, it is okay. It is okay, and no third party can interfere into it. But then problem begins where there is no consent of this party to accepting such comments. Implied or explicit threat of detrimental treatment. Implied or explicit threat about the present or future employment status. Interference with the work or creating offensive or hostile work environment. We shall be discussing what shall be treated as hostile work environment. And humiliating treatment by words and actions likely to affect her health and safety for non-acceptance of such behavior of the other party. Hostile work environment could include the following things: creating immense pressure for task completion, pressure for discussions, meetings at places other than the workplace, making offensive remarks about looks, clothing, or body parts of a female employee, touching or staring in a way that may make an individual feel uncomfortable, telling sexual jokes, sharing sexual posters. This will be treated as creating hostile environment at workplace. Using racially derogatory words, phrases, epithets, comments about an individual's skin color or other racial religious characters, negative comments, negative stereotypes about an employee's birthplace or ancestry. Something like, agar kisi ko kaha gaya ki haan, aap mein toh aisa hi hoga na, aap mein toh isi tarah se dressing kiya jayega na, agar wo kisi ko sunne mein pasand nahi hai, toh it should be considered as creating an environment which is hostile, unwelcome. Here, the most important part of this legislation is the aggrieved woman who will get the protection under the act is extremely wide. It has given a multidimensional coverage to who shall be treated as an aggrieved woman, irrespective of her age or employment status, whether it is in organized or unorganized sector, public or private, and also covers clients, customers, and domestic workers as well. The workplace in the Vishakha guideline is not confined to the traditional office setup where there is a clear employer-employee relationship. The act goes much further to include organizations, departments, office, branch, units, etc. in public and in private sector, organized and unorganized, hospitals, nursing homes, and here comes our most important is educational institutions. Therefore, in the initial part of the lecture, I said it was the result of these Vishakha case guidelines which initiated with establishment of the Collegiate Women's Development Cell or Women's Development Cells and the Internal Complaints Committees in educational institutions. It also covers the sports institutes, stadiums, sports complex, and any place visited by the employee during the course of employment, including the transportation. Even non-traditional workplaces which involve telecommuting will also be covered under this law. It has a very, very multidimensional approach of being able to provide justice to all. The Internal Complaints Committee will be there in all the organizations, all the higher education institutions under the chairmanship of a woman employee. There would be two members having legal awareness, one member from non-governmental organization which is working for the cause of women should be incepted as a member. Minimum 50% of the members should be female employees. The employer, head of the office, has an obligation to help the complainant in filing the complaint. If not done so, the employer also can be held liable. The complaint can be filed within 3 months, 90 days from the date of cause of action. And if the complainant, the aggrieved party, is unable to do so as a result of shock or as a result of mental incompetency, then the legal representative of such party may file the complaint. The Internal Complaints Committee is supposed to complete the inquiry within a period of 90 days. They are expected to support the report in 10 days. Here, the most important part is the accord and compromise is possible only if the aggrieved woman wishes to do so. Here, the consent of the aggrieved woman plays an important role. And importantly, no consideration in the form of money can be awarded in the case of settlement. This is a very important provision in this law, so that the misuse of this provision will be inhibited. The complainant can get compensated for the mental pain and agony which the person has to suffer. The person can have the privilege of getting transferred to the other branch, can get compensated for the medical bills, and also entitled to the paid leave for around 90 days, up to limit of 90 days. The committee is required to complete the inquiry within a stipulated time of 90 days. On completion of the inquiry, the report will be sent to the employer or the district officer, as the case may be. They are mandated to take action on the report within 60 days. Ultimately, this is all aimed at having early redressal of the grievance. Every employer is required to constitute an internal complaints committee at each office or branch with minimum 10 or more employees. The district officer is required to constitute a local complaints committee at each district and, if required, at block level, depending on the size of the district. It is expected that the complaints committee should provide conciliation or should try to solve the problem by inviting both the parties and discussing the problem with them. And it also has all the rights. They can summon the party, they can give a notice, they can ask questions, have an inquiry, ask for evidences, everything. Before moving on to the laws related to women, all of us are aware of constitutional rights of women. Certain other legal rights which are bestowed upon women, specially for the purpose of they being women. But it is the Constitution of India and several other legislations together have helped women to identify their dignity in this 21st century through the lens of 21st century. When we look to the legal provisions and provisions related to women, I want to mention that there have been certain landmark decisions of the Honorable Supreme Court of India, which has paved the way for recognition of human worth of the women. The Indian Constitution has got or actually aims at establishing gender equality. There are certain provisions for directing the states to ensure that they cannot deny to any person equality before the law or equal protection of the laws within the territory of India, also have a direction of making special provisions related to women and children, and no discrimination on the grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. But then, what is the reality? In the year of 2021, for the purpose of my certain survey related to domestic violence, when I had interviewed certain female women workers at a construction site, they told us that they are paid less than their counterparts. The male laborers are paid more and the women are paid less. I'm talking to you about Indian scenario, but as I've taken this from Google, they are in their modern dresses. But actually, we are discussing the 21st century, but the gender disparity is still very much in existence. We all are aware about Article 21, which states that no person shall be deprived of the life or personal liberty. This article protects the dignity of an individual. Of an individual also includes the individual of a woman. See, dignity is not something which is an abstract concept. Dignity is something which can be felt. Dignity, if not protected, has a consequence of shattering that individual. And therefore, I have decided to discuss with you certain cases which I believe are important, where the Article 32 has been invoked for the purpose of assertion of their rights. The Supreme Court has played an important role in the recognition of human worth of women. This case is of 1966 in Bombay Labour Union versus International Franchisee and Messrs. etc. It is a case of women requiring to give up their position on getting married, and it was treated that this particular condition of the employment is unreasonable. Such kind of landmark legislations have paved the way to the women to face this 21st century with the change in their outlook. There is another important case of C.B. Muthamma versus Union of India. I have given the citation. An employee with the Indian Foreign Services required to seek permission before getting married, and rules governing the employment of women were discriminated. The Supreme Court said that they were discriminatory of Article 14 as well as Article 16 of equality of opportunity in matters of public employment. Why permission to get married? It was squashed. In this case of Nargesh Mirza versus Air India versus Nargesh Mirza, the flight attendant were supposed to get retire under three circumstances. One, upon turning 35 years old. Two, upon getting married. And three, upon first pregnancy. The court struck the rules down, holding that these requirements constituted official arbitrariness and it is hostile discrimination against women. These cases are really important in the 21st century also. In order to understand the judicial activism, in order to understand the importance of the role played by the Honorable Supreme Court of India, Neera Mathur's case, where a woman required versus LIC, Life Insurance Corporation of India, they required to divulge information related to their private information related to their menstruation and other health related information. When a particular employee was employed and had to go on maternity leave during the probation period, there was termination of the services, and that was challenged. The Supreme Court ordered reinstating on the grounds of satisfactory work. The Honorable Supreme Court said, it has been stated that if the work which has been allotted to her is unsatisfactory, then only you had grounds of termination during the probation period. These were the certain cases which I felt that they were of relevance in order to understand the role of the court behind establishment of the Internal Complaints Committee as well as the Collegiate Women's Development Cells at all educational institutions in higher education too. We have these established cells. We have legal provisions. We have the IPC also. But then I also want to discuss about this law of protection of women from domestic violence. This important law primarily looks to protect a wife, a female living partner, or a woman living in a household, like a mother or a sister, from domestic violence at the hands of husband, male living partner, or relatives. She or anybody on her behalf can file a complaint. Actually, this act is a torchbearer. This act does not only protect women inside the four walls, which is actually considered to be a safe place for any woman, but then it also creates a right in the woman, in a woman to identify her mental agonies, because this is the only act which has helped people to understand the torture which the women face. Dear participants, I have selected this particular slide here. During this pandemic, it has been reported that the cases of domestic violence have risen disproportionately, and to such proportions that if domestic violence is this, and if this entire thing is domestic violence or a wound of domestic violence, this small bandage is in the form of legal provisions which are available. This small bandage is not able to cover this entire wound of domestic violence. I have selected this slide to make all of you understand that this problem is of such magnitude. This problem is so rampant. This problem is a regular problem faced by working women, non-working women, empowered women, unempowered women, dependent and independent women, everywhere at large. Because up till now, if somebody was physically battered, it would be properly reported or it would have some kind of evidence to be shown. But it is this act which actually helps to identify the verbal, economic, emotional, and sexual violation of a woman, rights of women. I want to discuss three important more things with you. And this is an information which must be shared with the students as well as the faculties at higher education institution level. The victims of sexual assault have a right to anonymity. To ensure that her privacy is protected, a woman who has been sexually assaulted may record her statement alone before the district magistrate when the case is under trial or in the presence of female police officer. There are legal rights, like it is a right that a person cannot be stalked, and it is treated as an offense to follow a woman and contact or attempt to contact such woman to foster personal interaction repeatedly despite a clear indication of disinterest by such woman, or monitor the use of woman of the internet, email, or any other form of electronic communication shall be treated as stalking, and it is an offense. There is a provision of 0FIR. Wherever the incident has taken place, the victim can file a 0FIR, and later on, the same shall be transferred to the respective police station under whose jurisdiction the incident has taken place. This 0FIR is something which will help the victims to immediately approach the police or approach the nearest police station and report the incident. With all these points, I would like to say that I have tried my level best to look at these provisions of establishment of the Internal Complaints Committee, its relevance, its reference, its importance at the higher education institutional level, through the lens of 21st century. We have had a journey of various landmark judgments, which I treat as the judgments which have protected the dignity of women. And ultimately, our journey is to create an atmosphere where women are treated at par with men. And therefore, this statement from me, in the hope of being human and treated as a human. Thank you, one and all. Thank you so much. Ultimately, when one speaks about the girl students coming to the college, the faculties at various places who have suffered some or the other kind of harassment at the on the part of their seniors or HODs or authorities rather. Establishment of these committees will create an atmosphere of understanding and identifying that this is not done. We cannot take any such step. Ultimately, I request all the participants to at least try and sensitize their students in their organizations so that there will be a marginal decline as well as the decline in the cases which are reported, in the cases in which our girls, our daughters, our girl students fall victim to such actions. Thank you so much. I'm thankful to everyone for allowing me to connect to all of you. The pandemic is still on. Stay safe, all of you. Thank you.